Good morning. I want to welcome those of you who are in the sanctuary to this place and to this time. I want to welcome you all who are part of the Facebook Live and YouTube gathering of our church. I want to welcome you to this morning. It has been a good morning so far, and just looking forward to gathering together again to worship the Lord. I have shared already a couple times this morning that I think that these are good days. And one of the reasons that I say that is that I think it was Tuesday, a friend of mine sent me a picture from Morristown or somewhere, New Jersey, and it was snowing. And I just went, what? And that is so incomprehensible to us in the in Pinellas County is a blessing, is something that we should celebrate. And you know, also Tampa Bay has gotten the Stanley Cup, and now we have the opportunity to think about the World Series. I mean, come on, really? How amazing is that? And so I think we come to praise the Lord for what he has done for us in our souls eternally. And that is reason for us to gather and to celebrate. But there are also other good things. And so we want to praise the Lord this morning and delight in his presence and with his people. We will do that in song and prayer and word and whatever, but before we do, I want to share a couple of announcements with you all. The first one is that today is our charge conference at 1:30. If you are not signed up for it, it's too late now. But know that that is happening, and if you have signed up, we're looking forward to seeing you on Zoom at 1:30. Number two, next Sunday, and this is something that you can participate in and hope that you will, and Rick, it's good to see you on the screen there with your piano mask there. That wasn't a robber or a terrorist. That was a keyboardist back there. All right. Yes, give Rick a hand. We need to pray for Rick, but also for our organ. Our organ has acted up this morning just before this service, and we're a little concerned about that. But anyway, what I wanted to say was that all of us can participate. Next Sunday, we are trying to fill the food pantry again for Pack a Snack. And so we're going to have a drop-off food drive from 9 in the morning till noon, just during church time. And so if you're coming to church, bring something. If you want to just drop by the church and drop something off, we would welcome that as well. We are busy feeding children at Melrose Elementary and at Fairmont Park, and we need your help to make that happen. The last thing I wanted to share with you is that next Sunday we're going to celebrate All Saints Day. And we do that in a couple of different ways, but one of the things that we do is we have candles that are lined up, and we remember members who have passed away since last All Saints Day. And this being the pandemic and whatever, we're very concerned that we have missed some folk. And so if you have a family member, you know someone who's been a member who's passed away, if you would contact Kendra, I think we've got her address up on the, or can get it up on the screen. We'd love to hear from you. We will remember different ones who are significant to us. We'll celebrate that together, but specifically members is something that we're concerned about. We're going to celebrate All Saints Day. I just want to recognize to you all that it's going to be a Sunday early, but I like to do that so that we are reminded of the beauty of the hallowed evening and the church's intent of that being a holy and a beautiful thing instead of kind of the scary and whatever things that it's become in our culture. So that is coming up. I think now we're going to enter into our time of worship, and I want to ask Rick if he will lead us with Song of the Bells as we prepare our hearts for our worship this morning. Pray. Lord, when I started out for the church this morning, it was pretty early, and when I walked out of the house, it felt cool, and it was just wonderful. When I got into the car, it said it was 72 degrees, which in Morristown, New Jersey, would be a heat wave, but for us here, it was a cool morning. And the stars were out. It was still dark, and it was just beautiful. And then as I drove, the sun started rising, and the skies became colorful. And the truth of Psalm 19 became very evident when it says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. night after night, they reveal knowledge. Lord, we come recognizing that we have many blessings, many gifts, that we delight in you. But we also come recognizing that as part of that creation, we don't always declare the glory of God or proclaim your works. Day after day, nature does, but sometimes we don't. And I ask that we today would be full of praise and full of recognizing your glory. And Lord, I ask that you would fill this place with your grace and your mercy. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me? We're going to have a call to worship. It invites us into to that worship and praise this morning. God has given us breath to live and a spirit to sing. Thanks. God has gathered us into a community of care and worship. Let us worship God with love, thanksgiving, and praise. Indeed, I think it's appropriate that we follow that up with our hymn of praise, which says, "Come, Christians, join to sing." Let's sing together. Affirmation of faith. Very often we have affirmations that have come from the tradition of our church, but today we're going to join in an affirmation that comes from 1 Corinthians 15 and the book of Colossians. So let us join together. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved. Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised on the third day. He appeared first to women, then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body, the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen. You may be seated.
Wide enough for my me, and in this very room.
If Jesus is indeed in this room, let us pray in his name together. Please join me with the words that are going to be on the screen. Spirit of the living God, though we are many, we have come together with one purpose, to worship you with scripture, song, and prayer. We witness that we are members of your body and wait for your words spoken clearly in our midst. May your presence be among us in this hour. Touch us with tenderness and strengthen us into commitment through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Let us continue in prayer this morning. Lord, let me just recall that psalm. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from, yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the end of the world. Lord, I thank you that nature proclaims your glory, that indeed there is the exaltation of you, the recognition of your work. Lord, yet somehow we are evidence of the work of your hands. We are your creatures, and unlike nature that day after day pours forth speech, well, we pour forth speech, but it's not always praise. It's not always to your glory. It is not always proclamation. We complain, we doubt, we malign, we complain, we are angry, we do all kinds of things. Lord, I ask that we be a people that are of praise, that you would focus us on your grace and on your mercy, and that we would see your blessing and recognize it around us, recognize it in others. Lord, we are very mindful of needs that are all around us. We would present those to you and dare to present them to you, recognizing that there is pain, there is concern amongst us. Many of us have health issues with ourselves or with family members, and we raise them to you. Some of us have experienced loss of a loved one. And Lord, I raise those families to you. And in this week in particular for me, I have been mindful of students, whether that be students in our preschool or students in our Sunday school here, but also the children at these two schools that we have been involved with, Melrose and Fairmont Park. And the struggles that they have and their teachers as well. Lord, I can't imagine what it would be like to try to keep children entertained that are in front of you, never mind those who are on Zoom. We have high school students who are dealing with the fact that so much that made the high school experience delightful is being curtailed for one reason or another. And never mind those who are in college. I think particularly of freshmen who can't leave their dorms, who are doing their classes all remotely, who can't even go to the library. Lord, for those young men and women, I ask your blessing upon them. And Lord, we would, I guess, just amplify all of that and ask your blessing upon this nation and the time of decision that is coming our way. And as the pandemic raises its head again and around the world, Lord, I ask that you would take this plague from us, but also that you would take the anxiety away from us so that we wouldn't just react emotionally, but that we would act according to your will. Be that on the street, be that in the church, wherever it happens to be. Lord, we are dependent on you and need you to be leading us, and we need to hear a good word from you. And Lord, I thank you that we can come and do that here. I thank you for Kerry and the ministry that he is going to bring to us here in just a minute. We ask your blessing on this time and all that we do. In Jesus' name, who taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn here as we get prepared to hear the word. It's called Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. And the refrain of that made our hymnal. And so in the Methodist Church for the last 30 years or so, we have kind of only heard the refrain, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. And it's absolutely beautiful. But there are words, there are verses to this song. And so I'm going to ask if Rick will just play the song, we'll join him in the refrain, and then we will sing the first and the last verses. Rick, would you lead us? I want to invite us to prepare our hearts to worship in with our tithes and offerings, a more tangible way of giving our praise to God. For those of you in the sanctuary, we have a box on the, as you go out, and want to invite you to use that. If you are with us online, please feel free to send us a check, or as we say every Sunday, stop by, drop it off. We'd love to say hi to you. But in either way, I'm going to ask Rick to prepare us for this with a song called Devotion. Today, we have a special guest preacher. Today in the church calendar, it says that it's Laity Sunday. And I've never known exactly what that means, except that we should hear from a lay person. And so I just started thinking about the lay leader who would come and share with us. And you need to know that Kerry is our lay leader at St. Pete First. You all haven't seen him as much in this service. He plays the saxophone every Sunday with the praise team at the 9:30 service. Kerry is the head of marketing for the Tampa Bay, I almost said St. Pete Times. He is also a professor at USF, teaching in the business school and marketing. And he and Linda Kay have been members here for 20 years or so. Which means that their two girls have grown up in our children's ministry and our youth program. One of them is off to college, and one of those that I was praying for this morning. And their other daughter is at the great institution of the Pinellas County Center for the Arts, and leads in worship at 9:30 as well sometimes. Just a great, great family. And Kerry has been a great friend to me personally, but to our church. His dedication to the Lord has just been exemplified over and over in his service here. And it's just a delight to have him share what the Lord has laid on his heart with us. And so I want to ask you to help me welcome him here this morning. I present to you Kerry O'Reilly.
Kerry, come.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Amateur Hour at St. Pete First. Pastor Craig, I want to thank you for the kind introduction. It's an honor to be here with you this morning to share the message. Now, as you've probably determined by now, I am not an ordained pastor. I don't have a master's in divinity from Duke University. I have a marketing degree from the University of Tennessee, y'all. Now, since I've never given a sermon before, I asked Pastor Travis for some words of wisdom. I said, Travis, do you have any advice for a rookie? He said, I do. In fact, it's pretty simple. Just follow the 5 B's. Well, I'm thinking, Bible, believers. Nope. He said, be brief, brother, be brief. Y'all at home, you're not seeing this, but I think I saw someone in the back do one of these. Yes, we're getting out early. Well, I'm sorry to disappoint, because when I shared my draft with Pastor Craig, he said, that's great, but can you make it 3 times longer? So it's somewhere in between, gentlemen. But for all of you here and for watching online, I promise I'll get you out by the time the Bucks game starts, which is at 4 o'clock. All right, so some of you may be wondering, what is a lay leader? Well, when the nominations committee asked me to serve in the role, I was wondering the same thing myself. And I initially declined, thinking there's got to be someone more worthy than me. But when Pastor Craig reapproached, I agreed. And I'll tell you why in just a minute. But now here we are in October, 10 months into the job, and I think now I finally have a better handle on what it means to be lay leader. Let me give you an analogy. Raise your hand if you are familiar with the ice cream store on 4th Street that looks like a red barn. Becky, do we have a photo of the red barn? This is what us professional marketers call aided recall. All right, I saw some hands go up here. On Facebook, put a thumbs up on Facebook. Seriously, do it now. If you are familiar with this ice cream parlor on 4th Street, looks like a red barn. It's called Old Farmer's Creamery. Okay, now if you're on Facebook, you're at your computer, take a second now and type in your favorite flavor of ice cream at Old Farmer's Creamery. Type in your favorite flavor right now. I'm going to ask you all here in the sanctuary, shout out loud enough so I can hear through your masks, what is your favorite flavor of ice cream at Old Farmer's Creamery? What do we got? We've got a bunch. I'm sorry, go over here. Chocolate chip, excellent. Mint chocolate chip, okay. Smoky Mountain chocolate, we haven't heard that one before. That sounds delicious. What else? What else we got? Raspberry, oh, I love that. Anybody else in the back? Coconut, okay, great, great. Janice, a favorite flavor?
Mint chocolate chip.
Mint chocolate chip, Pastor Craig, same thing, a smart man. Pastor Travis, anything new coming in on Facebook? Oh, butter pecan, chocolate, peanut butter, chocolate, excellent. What was that? Butter pecan, all right. I haven't tried that yet, but a lot of people like it. So being the lay leader at the church is like being in charge of making an ice cream run for the church, but you can only bring back one flavor for everybody. One flavor, that's easy. Pralines and cream, it's delicious. The vanilla and the caramel all swirled together and those sweet little pralines. Who could not love pralines and cream? My wife apparently does not love pralines and cream. She says, Kerry, it's gross. Who wants peanuts? Who wants nuts and ice cream? Well, to settle the matter, we sought the input from an expert. Our youngest daughter, Becca, who works at Old Farmer's Creamery. I said, Becca, what is the most popular flavor of ice cream at Old Farmer's Creamery? She said, Dad, it's all over the board, from rum raisin to cookie dough. She said she and her coworkers like to play a little game. They like to try to guess what flavor of ice cream someone will order based on their appearance. So I pictured the game going something like this. Let's see. Polo shirt, pressed, pleated khaki shorts, white tennis shoes. Looks like a vanilla. Nope. Neapolitan. Or she's got a colorful dress, colorful hair, makeup, shoes, rainbow sherbet, slam dunk. Nope. Pistachio. She said once a young girl came in, ordered a root beer float, but instead of root beer, she asked for orange Fanta. And instead of vanilla ice cream, cotton candy ice cream. Plus whipped cream, plus sprinkles. Ew. But who am I to judge? Here's what we can all agree on. We all like ice cream. No one flavor is right, and no one flavor is wrong. Y'all, what I believe is that what unites us is greater than what divides us. In this case, it's ice cream. But in the case of St. Pete First United Methodist Church, it's something bigger than that. What the pillar chairs, church council, staff, clergy, and I try to do is guide the church to what unites us, which is Jesus. The love he shows for us, the forgiveness he grants us, the grace he provides us, the comfort he gives us, the blessings he bestows upon us, his challenge to grow his kingdom in St. Petersburg, Florida. That's it. Nothing more. So I ask that you give grace when you're sharing your opinions and feedback with your staff, clergy, and lay leaders, and remember that what unites us is greater than what divides us. Y'all, in 2021, we are going to have some decisions to make that could be divisive, but we must stick together. To quote the Apostle Paul, in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to one another. Now let's pick back up on the theme of ice cream. Let's talk about the rocky road that our protagonists are on in the book, The Pilgrim's Progress. Now for those of you joining us for the first time, Pilgrim's Progress is a book we've been reading and discussing for the past several weeks. The main characters are Christian and his companion, Hopeful. Now, if you're not reading the book, that's okay. Just picture these guys, Becky, if you wouldn't mind. Yeah, about 3,000 years different. So Christian and Hopeful are on a journey to the celestial city. Along the way, they are tempted and tested by some bad actors, by the names of Mr. Envy, Mr. Unforgiving, Mr. Malice. Boy, if identifying sin was only that easy, it would make our job as Christians so much easier, wouldn't it? Like if they wore those name tags like, hello, my name is Mr. Envy. Or if you're at Starbucks and you hear the barista yell out, Lord Lusty, your cappuccino is up. Stay away from that guy, ladies. What I found is that not only am I a poor judge of whom among us are these bad guys, but oftentimes they're inside of me, popping their heads up when I'm most vulnerable. Christian shares the story about a man named Little Faith. In the story, Little Faith lets his guard down and is accosted by three vigilantes named Faint Heart, Mistrust, and Guilt. Have you ever been accosted by sin when you've let your guard down? When are you vulnerable? How do you overcome it? Have you ever shared your strategies or weaknesses with your brothers and sisters in Christ? Have you ever shared your strategies for how you overcome those weak moments? My friend Ray Hardman shared with me the acronym HALT. It stands for hungry, angry, lonely, and tired. It's those times, he said, when he is most vulnerable. And you know what? I was thankful he shared it with me, because what I discovered was that the same is true for me. And you know what? I think it's true for others too, because it's the premise behind a marketing campaign that's been extremely successful and has been running for over 10 years. It's from Snickers. The campaign is, "You're not you when you're hungry." How many of you are familiar with this campaign? Yeah, about half of you, okay. Put a thumbs up in Facebook if you're familiar with this Snickers campaign. If you're not familiar with it, Becky, would you mind showing one of the commercials? We've got one of my favorite 30-second commercials from this campaign.
What is your deal,
oh,
man?
Oh, come on, man. You've been riding me all day.
Mike, you're playing like Betty White out there.
That's not what your girlfriend says.
Oh. Baby. Whoa. Use Snickers. Better?
Better.
Hey. I'm open!
That hurt.
You're not you when you're hungry. Snickers satisfies.
So here's what we've learned today so far. Abe Vigoda and Betty White are not good football players. And Snickers satisfies when you're hungry. But what about when you're angry, lonely, or tired? I found that having a few scriptures memorized or tucked in your wallet or purse or saved on your phone can be helpful. I'd like to share with you a few of my favorites. This first one was particularly apt this morning. It comes from Philippians. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Another one of my favorites comes from Paul's letters to the Corinthians. It goes like this: no temptation has overtaken you that is uncommon to man. And God is faithful. He won't allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear. And when you are tempted, He will also provide a way of escape so that you can rise up and endure it. Now, in addition to being angry, hungry, angry, lonely, and tired, I find that I'm vulnerable when I'm afraid. And you see, fear is at the root of regret. We fear the regret of wasting time. We fear the regret of wasting money. When I go to Old Farmer's Creamery, I rarely try a new flavor. Why? Because I fear regret. It's crazy. One scoop on a sugar cone costs $4.65, but I'm afraid I may regret my decision, as if ice cream will go extinct tomorrow, or I may not have $4.65 tomorrow. But I am certain that pralines and cream will be delicious. I can taste it on my tongue. I'm not so certain about butter pecan. Let's see, I know I like butter. And I know I like pecans, but butter pecan, I'm just not certain about. You see, our minds have trouble comprehending abstract things. We prefer concrete objects, things that we can touch, taste, feel, or see, which is what makes being Christians so difficult. We need to believe in something we cannot touch, taste, feel, or see. Here's what Paul said to the Corinthians. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Now let's talk about the temporary and eternal for a second. When little Faith gets mugged by the three hooligans, they steal his bag of silver, but not the certificate that allows him into this celestial gate, nor his jewels. Why? Here's my theory. Silver has great value to characters like faint heart, mistrust, and guilt. To assuage our guilt, what do? We throw money at it. Entire industries have been built on this premise, from greeting cards to flowers. In the words of the much lesser prophet Homer Simpson, he says, "Marge, nothing says I'm sorry better than flowers. Except for fundamental behavioral change, but you can't buy that at the supermarket." Now let's talk about mistrust. Mistrust has fueled industries as well, from those little tiny cameras to microscopic recording devices so we can spy on each other. Now, how about faint heart? Faint heart, or the faint of heart, we have to have full silos to be sure that we'll be able to eat tomorrow. Nothing sows the seeds of doubt that perhaps only a big bank account can satisfy, right? Of course, as faithful Christians, we never fall into these traps. I know I do. We all do. We're humans. We're not Jesus. The jewels, though, the jewels. The jewels are a metaphor for the gifts that God gave us that can't be taken away. Now, I told you I would explain why I agreed to serve as lay leader. It's because I find joy watching and seeing the gifts that God gave each of you that he didn't give me in action. I am amazed by the faithfulness and devotion and courage of a Gordon Norton. I am in awe of the command of numbers of our finance committee. I'm blown away by the command of details that our trustees have, the passion and the care that our staff parish committee has. That gives me great joy to be a part of the body of Christ here on earth, to serve alongside each of you who are willing to use the gifts that God gave you to grow his kingdom here in St. Petersburg. Even though it's rewarding and it's what God calls us to do, it's not easy to serve the Lord. Heck, it's not easy being a Christian. It's a difficult path that requires humility, discipline, and sacrifice. All things we struggle with. So, how do we do it? I offer you these three strategies. But first, a marketing insight. Research tells us that recall of a message is strongest at the beginning of an event and at the end of an event, as evidenced by this U-shaped curve here you see on the screen. You see, when given 10 words, after 20 seconds, people recalled the first two words and the last word best. Well, now I've got a problem, everybody. Here we are in the middle of my sermon. I'm about to deliver my words of wisdom. And you're in the trough of this U-shaped curve when recall is the lowest. Well, research also tells us that our minds reset, recalibrate, and focus more keenly immediately after we laugh, right after a joke. So, I've got a joke for you. Now, truth be told, when I was rehearsing my sermon for my wife, I got to this point, I told her the joke, and she says, "Kerry, you really aren't going to tell the joke, are you?" I said, "Honey, research supports it. I have to." And she says, "But that joke?" I said, "It's the only joke I can remember." So here it is. Sorry. Two peanuts were walking down the street. One was assaulted. That's all I got. Okay, now we're ready. Three strategies for navigating the rocky road. Number one, be someone's hopeful. Be someone's hopeful. In the book, Christian had traveling companions like Faithful and Hopeful. At one point, Faithful dies, and Hopeful steps in. Have you ever lost faith? You ever had it shaken to the core? Ever had it shaken at all? Yeah. I think we all have. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2 says, "Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ." Traveling down the rocky road is a lot easier when you have someone to encourage you, to pick you up. Pastor Craig, I want to thank you for being that person for me a number of times. 2 weeks ago, I ran into a neighbor. He has a wooden cross in his front yard. It's about waist high. He put it up during Lent and never took it down. I respected him for that. I said, "Joe, I like that cross in your yard. I'm glad you kept it up after Easter." He said, "Kerry, kind of surprised to hear you say that, considering you work at the newspaper." Well, maybe he was joking. We'll go with that. But it still stung a little bit. Let's not be like that. Let's not judge people by their appearances. Because like trying to predict someone's favorite flavor of ice cream, we will probably get it wrong. The Catholic priest at the church I used to attend when we lived in Nashville had a prayer that stuck with me. Every Sunday he would pray, "Let us ask for forgiveness for the times we hurt each other, particularly the ones we love the most." Isn't that odd? We can be more polite to the Publix cashier than our own family members, our own brothers and sisters in Christ. Number two, remember God's faithfulness. When I recall all that God has done for me and the trouble he's bailed me out of, all of a sudden, the abstract becomes concrete. Remember the words from the song? "Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me." Matthew chapter 6, verses 28 through 30 says, "And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon in all his glory was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, He will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So the next time you marvel at the sunset in St. Petersburg or the stars that you see as you get up and it's still dark out that Pastor Craig reflected on this morning, or the images we saw when Rick was playing, think of those as concrete examples of God's faithfulness. Number three, trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. One of the joys of my life was participating in Wilderness Trail. Those of you who have been on trail, what do we say about the process? It's a three-word phrase. Anybody here participated in trail willing to shout out that three-word phrase? Yeah, trust the process. Thank you, Becky. Awesome. That means don't worry about what time it is. Don't worry about what's for dinner. Don't worry about your feet hurting. Don't worry about what's happening on Instagram. Trust the process. This past summer, my daughters Becca and McKenna and I went hiking in South Carolina, and it was a blast. But after a little bit of reflection, I feel like I didn't enjoy it quite as much as trail. It was a different type of joy. I think because trail is a spiritual journey. Now, believe me, as the only adult in the group, I was praying that we didn't get lost, and God was with us. But there was a different kind of mission altogether. Let's keep God in our mission as we journey together, and not worry about the small matters, and trust in Him always. He will direct our paths. And the next time you pass that little red barn on 4th Street, think about the rocky road and how taking it can bring such joy. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You for all the blessings You give us, from Your Scripture to Your people to Your church to the diversity of ideas and experience and disciplines and talents. I ask that we are able to discern Your will as we work together to grow Your kingdom here in St. Petersburg. Bring us peace and joy and comfort today and for the week ahead. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Kerry, for sharing the word with us. I think we're going to close with "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus." Great Is Thy Faithfulness that you just shared. But before we do, I would like to invite Steve and Trishna to come forward. They have gone through the new members class, and last week we received several new members, but they were out of town. Here, you don't have to jump it. There you go. All right. And we're just delighted to be receiving them. Guys, if you would just kind of stand there. We talked about the questions that we present at the for every member, and want to ask those of you, and we are just excited for both of you to be coming and joining us. I have gotten to know these two kind of during the pandemic. They've been part of our Bible study, and it's just been great to get to know you guys. And on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Your answer is, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you through the resurrection of Jesus to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Your answer is, I do. And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord? Your answer is, I do. And so in these questions, we determine that they are Christians, that they love the Lord, and that they have given their hearts to him. And so then, as this says, as members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? Your answer is, I will. And as members of this congregation of St. Pete First, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Your answer is, I will. And members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. Would you please join me in responding to them? We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in the congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in its ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Guys, again, welcome, and I want to present this to you, and Steve, want to present this to you guys. We are so delighted that you are part of us, and I can't just warmly embrace you because of the pandemic, but just feel it and know that we all are doing the same. If you would affirm that embrace, would you just clap and welcome them? Guys, have a seat, and well, don't sit down. Just show us how we stand and sing. Go back to your seat. Would you please stand together? We're going to sing Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let's sing the first and the last verse of that song. May God the Father, who intended all things good, may God the Son, who by opening his arms on a cross reconciled us to that good God, and may God the Holy Spirit, who allows us to walk on that rocky road, go with you now forevermore till we meet again. Amen. God bless you. If you'd follow the instructions of the ushers as you leave, we will listen to an usher by a guy who's not a terrorist. He's just wearing a mask with a keyboard on, Rick Ney.